The Philippines is actively participating in the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework and the APEC meetings leading up to the Leaders Summit in San Francisco in November. I look forward to joining fellow APEC leaders in California later this year. This will be my third trip to the U.S. since I assumed office. With energy security high in the economic agenda, we are particularly interested in sustainable land, water, and ocean solutions that align with our climate goals and support our plans to transform the Philippines into an upper middle income country by the year 2025. All efforts to increase the number of power sources lean towards clean energy. That being the case, I am interested in the potential of nuclear energy, especially in light of new technologies and innovations that allow the use of smaller scale modular nuclear reactors, other advanced technologies that we see as being safer from the more and more efficient than the more traditional designs of nuclear power production. Leading the charge are our ongoing discussions with the United States on the 123 agreement, which will provide the legal framework for civil and nuclear-related investments, particularly in nuclear power in our country. Together with the United States and other partners, especially the private sector, we will build the necessary infrastructure to help power a growing economy as we transition to clean and renewable energy. We recognize the rule of the rule that we have set for ourselves, that is the slow transition, and it is slow. We all had great hopes that the transition to renewables would be easy or simple. It turns out that that's not going to be the case, and we have to be realistic in this regard. And so the rule we have applied for ourselves is, first of all, is that we must be able to provide sufficient power for the development of our industries, sufficient power so that we can expand the economy, and it must be accompanied by a continuing effort to move our power sources from the traditional fossil fuels to renewable sources of energy. I hope to see more engagements involving both our governments and private sectors, especially in mobilizing financial resources for investment in key areas such as critical infrastructure, research and development, and human capital development. I hope we can count on your support for this. I cannot stress more how important private sector support has been to all the planning that we have done. One of the key features of the economic policy since I took office is that we have initiated, we started with what we call a whole of government approach, seeing as the problems that we face post-pandemic and with Ukraine, with the developing and evolving situation in the war in Ukraine, we have put front and center in terms of our plans of transforming the economy, strong partnerships with the private sector. We started, as I said, with a whole of government approach, wherein government approached every problem, every challenge, every new program. Not with a single department, not with a single agency, but bringing to bear as many of those agencies that may be relevant to that particular program. And that has been a multiplier effect. So we have extended this now to what we call the whole of nation approach. And that's why the private sector has been recognized as a critical partner if we are to continue the transformation of our economy. My economic managers and I have been pursuing and implementing reforms to attract more foreign investment and expand commerce not only domestically, but of course, also globally. I'm happy to report that the Philippines is on track not only for economic recovery, but to achieving an upper middle economic status within a couple of years. Despite global economic headwinds, our GDP post-pandemic defied predictions through sound economic and fiscal policies, responsive reforms, and an enabling economic environment that drove commerce and domestic consumption. We would like to continue the trend of growth in terms of the growth of our economy, our GDP, in the coming years. We have done reasonably well in the past year or so, but there are some new forces that have come into play, not least of which is the canceling of the Black Sea Agreement by Russia in terms of the export of agricultural products. And the effect has been, once again, has reached all the way across the globe, and we are beginning to feel the effect of that as food prices continue to be volatile, and unfortunately volatile in to be higher in terms of pricing. And we have identified agriculture as a priority, the first priority actually, not only because it is absolutely necessary that the state is able to feed its own people, its own populace, and to provide that food supply in a pricing structure that is actually affordable to people. And that is, but beyond the primordial mission of feeding the populace, the economic analysts have made it very clear that any transformation and any industrialization cannot really take place unless our agricultural sector is secure, our agricultural sector is robust, and our agricultural sector is efficient. And in that, to that end, we have slowly been working to improve the value chain of our agricultural sector, all the way from our research and development to providing financing, providing the inputs to our farmers, providing the new technologies to the new techniques and new strategies for farming. Of course, we have encountered problems, of course, in stress, especially in the livestock, because of the prevalence and the contagion of the swine flu and the avian flu. But these are the things that we are working towards. And again, the private sector has been an absolutely critical partner in that regard. So despite headwinds, our GDP post-pandemic has been able to do reasonably well, you know, because of all that we have done. We hope to continue that growth trend in the Philippines in terms of our GDP. We were originally, as the estimate of the World Bank originally for the Philippines was 5% growth for this year. That has been upgraded to 6%. There are new shocks that have come in, but I think we can take measures to continue the growth rate of our economy. Well, these came from aggressive infrastructure projects. We have undertaken perhaps the largest infrastructure program that the Philippines has seen, especially in terms of monies that are funding that has been appropriated by our legislature for this year and for the next year. We have reformed the bureaucracy so as to be more attuned to the way that we do business today. I always say that the people have said that we would like to recover the economy. And I immediately disabused them of that. I do not want to recover the economy. I do not want to be where we were in September 2019. I want to be where we should be for 2026, for 2028. We have to recognize that it is a different situation that we are facing now. The world has changed. Pandemic, the COVID changed everything. And we must resign ourselves to that difficult fact, and that's what we are trying to do: to look forward and to see how the evolution of our new economies are going. And in the region, in ASEAN, for example, the leaders have come to a consensus, very clear consensus, that what we really need to do, if we are to regain the leadership in the economic development for the rest of the world, as we had in 2019, 2018, where we were the most here, this region was the most aggressive in terms of trade, in terms of growth. To return to the very first thing that we must do is improve our connectivity. Now, we tend to think, when we say connectivity, we think digital. Well, that applies as well. But physical connectivity now is the key. Connectivity by air, by land, by sea. And that is what we are hoping to achieve in the next meetings with ASEAN, amongst the leaders, amongst our business partners. And this, I think, is the right, I think that we have made the right decision in that regard. I think we are going down the correct road, and by we, I mean as ASEAN, that we must develop first the infrastructure, we must develop first the basic bones of our economy in the way that is required by the new global economy post-pandemic. So these are the elements that we have tried to put together to continue the growth rate of the Philippines. We decided very early on that although we worry about our debt to GDP ratio in the Philippines, as it stands, it's about 63%, and that's a little high for us, and it is not ideal. I would say we are doing better than our neighbors, perhaps, but nonetheless, it's still something that we need to be looking at. And the way that we believe we can pull ourselves out of that debt ratio and improve that debt ratio is through growth. And that is why we are working very hard to continue with that growth trend. We are, however, beset by the problems of inflation. And that is why the monetary policy has been quite robust and increasing. But then we worry about the constriction of the economy by very high interest rates. And so this is something that we have to balance. But in terms of the ordinary man on the street, inflation, of course, is they do not worry about your GDP, debt to GDP ratio. They just know that the prices of everyday goods, products that they need for their everyday life is just going up. Fuel is going up. We just had another increase today. So these are the balances that these are the balls that we have juggling in the air. I don't think it is just the Philippines that is in that condition. I think it is really the rest of the world. We all have to try and find new ways to address the problems that we are facing, as the nature of those problems is different from what they were a few years ago. And the other overwhelming factor now, especially here in the Philippines, are the effects of climate change. I have said it before, I think it bears repeating, that no discussion, certainly at my level, can be had and can be complete without touching upon climate change. It affects everything. It affects our healthcare system. It affects our infrastructure program. It affects our educational program, who goes to school, who doesn't go to school, who can, all of the, every little sector in our society, the everyday life of our people, maybe they do not know it, but from my point of view, sitting here where I am, I can see that every aspect of everyday life is affected by climate change. And the Philippines has the dubious distinction of being one of the most vulnerable when it comes to the effects of climate change. And so that has factored in a great deal to all of our planning and all that we do to improve the economy. And I must say that from where we began, there has been I'm talking now not only about the Philippines, but even ASEAN. From where we stand, we can see that the developed countries, and for lack of a better term, the developed countries are being willing to take on the load to mitigate the effects of climate change. It is the calculation, the formulae that we have to decide upon. We are not yet there, but I can see that there's progress in that regard. But I think it is so important that it bears repeating that climate change really enters into every aspect. If we're going to talk about the economy, I think I need not explain to you, ladies and gentlemen, how that has become a major factor in all our thinking. And from an ordinary citizen's point of view, it's the same thing, that they have to be able to adjust. We have resigned ourselves to going past 1.5 degrees in terms of global warming. We have not been able to hold it back for many, many, many reasons. So we now try to look at mitigation and adaptation. And for that, we certainly need the synergies that will come about by alliances, partnerships, arrangements with our ASEAN partners, and beyond that, of course, our American partners, who have been playing a very large part in that aspect of our development. So I recognize the critical role that the United States and American businesses have played in advancing a robust and inclusive economic growth in the Philippines, not only in this period, but for a very long time now. I invite the members of the esteemed Council to continue being valuable partners of the Philippines. Well, let us push for greater economic engagement between our two countries for our mutual benefit, for the prosperity, especially of the region. Thank you. And I wish you all a productive and enjoyable stay in the Philippines. Maraming salamat po.
If I may just say a few words, envying us here this morning. And I know that we've heard you many times in your speeches talk about, in your public remarks, that economic security is national security. And in that regard, we in the United States are very honored to be your steadfast friends, your ironclad allies, and also your key partner in prosperity. And in this regard, this is the second major trade and investment delegation, business delegation that we've received here in Manila just within the last month. It is the very largest U.S.-ASEAN Business Council, USABC Business Council delegation ever to visit, and we think maybe the largest ever in the history of our bilateral relationship, certainly in recent memory. And that shows the enthusiasm that American businesses have for this relationship and for the work that you and your team are doing. The priorities that you've outlined, I've said many times before that if the speeches on behalf of our U.S. economic team and the speeches on behalf of the Philippine team, if somehow we dropped the cards and the pages got mixed up, it'd be hard to know. which are the priorities of the Philippines, which are the priorities of the United States. They dovetail so neatly and so nicely. Represented here in the U.S. private sector is the very best of what the U.S. has to offer. These companies bring very high standards when it comes to quality jobs, leading technology, high environmental and labor standards. And with that, I want to keep my remarks very brief and turn it over to my friend, Ambassador Ted Osius, to introduce his delegation. We're very excited to have the U.S. ASEAN Business Council here. And again, thank you so much for having us.
Thank you, President. We're very honored that you have this meeting with us today. Thank you so much for receiving us. And I'm very glad to be doing this with my friend, Ambassador Mary Kay Carlson. Thank you for joining us, Ambassador. We're very honored to meet you during both of your U.S. visits, first in last year in the U.N. General Assembly, and then when you were guest of President Biden in Washington. We were very, very honored that you took time to see our members. And you've just spoken about the great strides being made in the relationship under your leadership based on the promotion of peace and the protection of national interest. This is your visits were very powerful signals of where the relationship is going under your leadership, sir. And I think we are all very appreciative of your leadership. As the ambassador mentioned, we have 30 companies here today. In the 40-year history of the U.S. ASEAN Business Council, we've never brought such a large delegation to the Philippines. And I think that's really a testament to the interest of our members in the strong growth, the sustainable approach that you're taking to the economy, the macroeconomic fundamentals, which are stable, your young and competent workforce, and your receptiveness to foreign investments. So we heard you on the whole of nation approach, and the interest of partnership in our businesses are responding. We look forward to deepening our engagements with your government and to creating more partnerships with companies here in the Philippines. We're very much focused, and you highlighted these themes on sustainable development, transformative digitalization, innovative healthcare solutions, supply chain resilience, and ease of doing business. You also mentioned, sir, in your State of the Nation address, and then again this morning, the importance of infrastructure, of agriculture, of clean energy, green metals, and semiconductors. And we hear your messages, and I think when you hear from our companies, you'll hear our responses to your messages. We are determined that we come here not just to talk, but also to bring about action, to create real partnerships, and to show our commitment in the form of investments. And I listen a lot to the discussions in Washington about the Philippines, and there's one message I felt is very important to bring from Washington about, and you mentioned it, sir, about Indo-Pacific Economic Framework and your participation in APEC. The view in Washington is that the Philippines has been an incredible partner in this process, especially in Pillar 2, the supply chain pillar of the Indo-Pacific Economic Framework, and the U.S. is looking for continued Philippine leadership on Pillar 3, which is focused on clean energy, decarbonization, and infrastructure, and Pillar 4, tax and anti-corruption. And U.S. companies, of course, welcome a transparent, predictable business environment in the context of Pillar 4. So with your permission, Mr. President, I would ask a number of our company members to make brief interventions in response to your remarks, sir, if that's okay. Thank you, sir.